だってぎなってへぎすぐ Well I love you gal yes I need you Peggy Sue I love you Peggy Sue Yes I love so very true Oh
ask you a question. How old are all of you fellas?
Well, there's 218, 120, and I'm 21.
Where do you come from? Lubbock, Texas?
Lubbock, Texas, yes.
You go to school down there?
Well, we did until we got out of high school, finally.
Right after high school, you started playing together?
Yes, sir, that's right.
Your big hit right from the start, or has it been sort of a long...
Well, we've had a few rough times, I guess you say, but we've been real lucky getting it this quick.
Well, Texas, nice to have you up here.
Thank
Let's
you,
have a very nice hand for these Texas records.
Buddy got most of his musical talent from mother's side of the family. My father loved music. He couldn't carry a tune in a bag, but he would insist on us playing. And most of the songs that we sang, of course, were Baptist songs and all old, golden oldies, we called them. And they still use them at the Baptist church that we go to.
They had an amateur contest, and Mother and Dad always wanted us to take Buddy because he was so cute, you know. And he was, he had a little violin, but he couldn't play it and just mess us up, we thought. But anyway, we took him out, and he did sing a song, and I think that might have been what caused us to win the contest. The name of it was, Have You Ever Gone Sailing Down the River of Memories? And it's an old song, but he sang it so cute, and but whenever we was playing, well, he'd fiddle right along with me, and Travis was playing the accordion. But we had grease on his bow, so you couldn't hear him. And we thought we was playing a good trick on him. He didn't ever know the difference at that time.
Well, initially, as I remember it, Mother and Dad gave him violin lessons, which he didn't care for at all. And later on, they got him a steel guitar. And that was about the age of 11, I believe. And he said, no, I don't want a guitar like that. I want one like Travis has got. So he would borrow mine.
Do you think of me, darling? While we're many miles apart.
Where are you all from? Where's your hometown?
Lubbock, Texas.
Well, how far is that from a place like Dallas or Crystal City? I mean, Texas is big, man.
Well, our hometown, Lubbock, is 280 miles straight west of Dallas.
Would you like to go back there?
Sure would.
What's the weather like this time of year down there?
Oh, it's not quite this cool.
It's not.
And it's a little bit drier.
For I can live while we're apart.
I met Buddy when I was about a sophomore in high school. And Buddy was playing with Bob Montgomery, and they had a little group together, and Buddy played the banjo, like a four-string banjo at the time. and Bob was playing the guitar. And I guess it's kind of like playing cowboys and Indians, you know, they were playing bluegrass music, and Buddy was being Earl Scruggs, and Bob was being Lester Flatt.
What sort of things were they playing?
Well, they were playing, if I can illustrate, I don't do too much bluegrass anymore. It's like standing on a corner with a low-down blues, a great big hole in the bottom of your shoes. Honey, let me be your salty dog. Let me be your salty dog, or I ain't gonna be your man at all. Honey, let me be your salty dog. Look at your woman, I know you. Run down, stocking down a worn-out shoe. Honey, let me be your salty dog. Let me be your salty dog, or I ain't gonna be your man at all. Honey, let me be your salty dog.
The summer we got out of school, we started really working around playing nightclubs, and as I said before, we played car lots and grocery store parking lots, and they'd have a remote broadcast from a radio station. They'd send a crew out, and we'd be on the air, you know, and man, we'd draw a big crowd. After we started picking, people would hear us on the radio, and they'd drive over. And we played in nightclubs when we were real young. It was really against the law, but for some reason or other, we got away with it.
Actually, I just prayed to God and asked him to make a
performance the champion for 1958.
Let's bring the crickets on, the fellows who work with you.
Okie dokie. Well, the first one here is Jerry Allison.
Jerry, nice to see you.
And he's the drummer for the Crickets.
Right up here on the right was 16th and J Club. I guess probably the first place I ever played with Buddy Holly. It's a vacant lot now. That's probably an improvement from the 16th and J Club, but it was a real joint. We played there. I played with Cal Wayne, the Riverside Ranch Hands at the time, when Buddy used to come and sit in with us and play like 40 cups of coffee and Bill Haley tunes. This is Lubbock High up here on the left. My Buddy graduated from there in 1955, and I graduated in 1956. But look, it's even ivy covered now, part of it. He didn't really change that much from the time I knew him in junior high school. We wore real, more inconspicuous type glasses, like with the wire rims, as opposed to, like saying, okay, I wear glasses and here they are. And I think when he finally decided he looked good with glasses on, it was but he always looked pretty well the same. Always had curly hair and always real neat dresser. Like he always liked his Levi's creased real nice, and iron starch shirts. And it was just a neat.
We would sit out in Buddy's car late at night. They had a show out of Shreveport, Louisiana called Stan's. Record stores, record rack, or something like that. And he didn't come on till something like midnight. So I'd go up and spend the night with Buddy, and he and I would go out at midnight and sit in the car and listen to this guy out of Shreveport. And he played really good blues stuff, you know, like Lonnie Johnson was the guy's name. Boy, he was terrific.
I won't be back until fall.
And a lot of black artists, you know. Seemed like Lead Belly was one. And we liked it a lot, and so that's probably where that blues influence came from.
Me and Buddy, he was working for me in the tile business, and we had a big tile job. Had to go to San Angelo to get a truckload of tile, and 18-wheeler, and I let him help me drive it down there. We sort of learned how together on the thing. Anyway, we got to San Angelo and went in this place to get a hamburger. It turned out to be more of a joint than anything else, but we stayed in there, and they had a black combo in there playing. And Buddy got to talking with them, and he knew their language, you know, and hanging around up there. And they said, hey, man, why don't you come up here and play us one? And he said, well, I don't mind if I do. And you know, he just dying too. He just had on his Levi's and his jeans. And anyway, as soon as he got that guitar, I would have swore it was a different instrument completely. just the way you pressed down on it or something, he made a clean sound. It was just a dead little joint when we went in, and it was rocking before we left.
About seniors in high school, Elvis came through the country, man, and he just started, and he was brand new. And we all just fell in love with that style of music because, mainly because the girls all liked it, you know. so that made us like it, too.
It was on a Sunday afternoon. It was at a show, and it was the first time we met Elvis. And we didn't know what he looked like. We had no pictures of him. So Buddy was there, and naturally Elvis had his first release, a 78 record. And Buddy wanted to see what he looked like, you know, as well as all of us. We didn't know what the guy looked like, you know. But we wanted to hear what this boy from Mississippi, or hear him and see him, you know, what he was like. And, of course, we did get to see him that day. Who else was on the show? Let's see, there was Johnny Cash. He was a young man at the time trying to get started. Buddy wasn't on that particular show because there were several more and really didn't have room for him, I guess is what what they said that day. Carl Perkins and his band was on the show. And of course, Elvis closed the show. And no one had ever seen him. I believe that was his first appearance. I'm sure about that. He only had two songs out, I believe, at that time. That's All Right, Mama, and Blue Moon of Kentucky. I know we would play it at the radio station because it was a bluegrass country type song, and the audience seemed to accept that, you know, because of the song.
We had a band very similar to Elvis. Buddy was Elvis, and I played like Scotty Moore. And we had a bass player, Don Guess, who could play slap bass, you know, that rhythmic slap-type bass is what we called it. He could play slap bass just like Bill Black. And, man, the next day when Elvis left town, when we were in business, man, we started booking out. Do the rhythm and the blues tonight. Rock is everything gonna be high. Cause tonight we're gonna rock. Well, I got a little gal I call Ivy, Ivy, come from Memphis, Memphis, Tennessee, and tonight we're gonna rock around with Ivy, Ivy, Ivy.
When Buddy asked me to play with the group, he said, "Why don't you, you know, join up with us, man, and be, you know, the bass player with the group all the time?" Said, "Big things are gonna happen," and said, "We're gonna cut a record, and it's gonna come out, and we're gonna have a hit and all that." And I says, "Of course, I'd heard that before, you know." And I said, "How long do you think it's going to take?" Buddy says, "How long did it take Elvis?" So, you know, I mean, right there was evident that Buddy was very confident in himself and what was going to happen with the group as a whole.
I lived here from the time I was about probably 12 years old, and we had our instruments set up in the back bed. My bedroom in the house was pretty big, and we set up our instruments there and rehearsed quite a bit. That's the house right over the brown shutter. We used to sit in that driveway there a lot and say, "How in the world are we going to make it?" Get your afraid each thing I do. Buddy and I had been to see a movie called The Searchers, and we were into playing a lot, like practicing almost every night then. We were sitting around just practicing. He was playing guitar and I was playing, sitting playing the drums in my mom's house.
And I'd never tried to write a song at the time.
Well, you want to quit either? That'll be that day.
Holly was playing this, like, had a tin in his head, and he said, hey, let's write a song. And I said, that'll be the day. He said, that's a good idea. And so he wrote it in about 30 minutes.
You say you're gonna leave, you know it's a lie, cause that'll be the day when I die.
Well, you give me all your loving and your turtle doving, all your hugs and kisses and your money too. Well, you know you love me, baby, still you tell me maybe that someday will I be. Well, that'll be the day when you say goodbye, yeah. That'll be the day when you make me cry. You say you're gonna leave, you know it's a lie, cause that'll be the day when I die. Well, that'll be the day when you say goodbye, yeah. That'll be the day when you make me cry. You say you're gonna leave, you know it's a lie, cause that'll be the day when I die. Well, that'll be the day.
The old studio was used last in 1969 when Norman moved out of there. This is the small studio. I think I'd call it small because most recording studios were big, that Buddy Holly and the Crickets did all of their hits, most all of their hits, I'd say, like That'll Be the Day and Peggy Sue, Every Day. And when these boys came in, I thought, are these boys musicians? And they looked real gangly to me, and they didn't look like they'd have any a talent at all. When they started playing, well, they showed us different. I don't think there was an actual boss. I really don't. I believe Norman would start it out, and if Buddy would have a suggestion, he would probably try it. He used different microphones. I mean, he would change microphones probably several times. But when we'd start rehearsing the numbers is when he would go around and set up microphones and get the sounds he wanted.
Was he a real perfectionist about it?
Yes, yes. And like I say, he may change microphones several times until he got just the exact sound that he wanted. But we'd have fun while he's doing all this, and it was when he was ready to get down to business and we got serious. And we have the control room right here. So I guess thinking of the older times, I'm not sure this was here when Buddy was here, but he had a disc cutter here that he did use to cut the records on. And of course he always kept time with things real good with the Western Union clock. So, and his tape recorders were over on that side. There's one or two over there. And this is the original board where many of the Buddy Holly and Cricket hits were done.
Hello.
Did you record it? Hello, hello, hello.
Can you speed the echo up, Eddie?
Speed the echo up.
Hey, can you go pa-pow, pa-pow, pa-pow again?
Yeah, do that right before the first part there.
Do it.
Okay, let's do it.
We did a lot of different things, like on Every Day. I played on my knees just when we were sort of working on the song, deciding what order to do it in to keep it quieter so everybody could hear what Buddy was doing on the guitar. I was just like sort of playing along on my knees, and Norman Petty said,
I don't remember exactly how it came about, but he said, let's try that. So just like Mike, just playing the knees like that. And on a song called Well Alright, just like all the way through, just played the, laid the cymbal, I think this very cymbal on the floor, and just played. Well alright, so I'm being too, and you know, no other drums on it. And then Party Doll, which had been cut close before that, Buddy Knox and the Rhythm Orchids. They used a cardboard box on that, so when we started to do Not Fade Away, we said, hey, that sounded good then, so let's do it again. And I'll show you how it sounds, because I just emptied a box last night. And I'll show you how it sounded like this. Well, all I want is a party doll. Be with me when I'm feeling wild. Be with Not Fade Away sounded like this. Well, I'm going to tell you how it's going to be. You're going to give your love.
Norman Petty called me one day and said, Maria, you got to hear something. I heard this one master, That'll Be the Day, and it just hit me between the eyes. I just loved it.
I think I played it for other people in the company.
Mm, you're right.
And everyone turned me down. Everyone said, yeah, we can't put a record like this out. No one liked it. They also thought that... from a musical standpoint, it might hurt the image of Carl Records, because we were recording people like Lawrence Welk and Teresa Brewer and the McGuire sisters.
Stephen Eady. Yeah. It was something very different. It was that rockabilly pop. I don't know what the heck it was at that time. It was something that hit us between the eyes. And then I think Bob should pick it up there, because I wasn't in sales. I was just delighted that we had a hit. And the cockroaches came out of the wall. Everybody wanted it. Everybody wanted him. Everybody wanted his songs. And then, of course, if I'm not mistaken, the next release was Peggy Sue.
That kind of stuff.
And how's that different from other guitarists?
Well, other guitarists will just play, a single string, or, I can't play like Chuck Berry, but, Chuck Berry played this kind of stuff. That kind of stuff, just on two strings or something.
You talked about him playing rhythm lead, not conventional lead. And how is Buddy different then?
He played on all the strings, Played a lot of downstrokes too, like everything was hard, like you can do the same thing like down and up, but Buddy played all downstrokes.
That's sort of how Peggy Sue went on the road and for TV, like live performances. And it's a lot different from it. Started out as Cindy Lou, like a Latin, I think it was maybe a rumba beat, went like. Cindy Lou, oh, how my heart yearns for you, oh. Anyway, there was an awful lot of Latin things around then, so we finally figured out to do it when we recorded it in the studio with paradiddles, just on one drum. And Norman Petty, the engineer, flipped the sound in and out of the echo chamber and changed the volume, or I think increased the dBs. Anyway, just played it on one drum like this.
I remember we were all on an Irving Fell tour, Show of Stars, and we knew that they were going to join the show. That was a Sunday or something. And they were all down in the basement of this big arena where we were playing, the three of them, wearing these gray suits that Catalia bought in Texas. They had grown up together. They were like, literally like brothers. They were wonderful, friendly. They were friendly. They were very, very into the, they had even a kind of a Texas language we didn't even understand at that time. A lot of things they would talk about and things. It was really kind of a little alien to Phil and I, you know. What? They were, well, I, just the way they, their sense of humor and everything. We learned, we, you know, we became such friends that, you know, over the years, it just became part of our life, you know, the way they were. They were a group, too, which they were self-contained, which Phil and I weren't even at that time. So it was really kind of a camaraderie there, you know, the beginning of rock and roll.
The first tour we went on, in 30 days, we'd play 30 places. And there were 3 days off, I think, for us on the whole, like a 17-week tour. We'd book in the first 3 weeks were like in theaters, like a week at a time, and after that was one nighters. And we went to Canada, from Canada to California and back to Canada, and play we only missed like 4 or 5 states on that tour.
You have to figure a bus loaded with, you know, everybody in the top 10. Frankie Lyman, and it was a lot of fun to be around, you know, and they'd sing, make up songs, and, you know, 99 bottles of beer on the wall, stuff like that, and just general kibitzing and a bunch of entertainers, people would be jamming. It just was, you know, I wouldn't take $1 billion for that. You know, those memories were really sensational. You'd sometimes sleep up in the rack and stuff like that, and sometimes you travel all night, but most of the time you were on the bus, you know. It was fun. It was tiring, but I was, you know, 18 years old, you know, young and healthy, could do it.
Did the older performers tend to look after the new bloods?
Yeah. Laverne Baker was on the tour, and Laverne was almost like a when your buttons came off your jacket, you know, you could go to Laverne, get him sewed on, that kind of thing. And it was just good, you know. It was really a lot of fun. It really was.
I'm gonna tell you how it's gonna be. Are you gonna give your love to me? I wanna love you night and day. You know my love will not fade away. Oh well, you know my love will not fade away.
It was really fun because they actually thought we were a black act when they booked us on the show. And so we were booked with, like in the Howard Theater in Washington, D.C., and the Royal in Baltimore, and the Apollo in New York. And it worked out great for us because all the people that were on the shows, that was our kind of music, and we were big fans of theirs. And it kind of, what we always heard is they listened, from listening to the record and also the fact there'd been a Black Crickets, but we thought, they think that we're black, and we thought, yeah, that's great, because that's what we were trying to sound, was like our black idols or whatever you'd call them. I mean, we were sort of a novelty, I think. And of course, they'd been like Little Richard had been through Lubbock, and we'd been to his shows and at the Cotton Club, like standing right in front, going, "Hey, all right," and you know, hanging out backstage and all that. So we halfway knew them. They sort of remembered us, but they were always real nice to us, and they were marveling that we were into what, you know. I mean, when somebody's a big fan of yours, you can't really be off them. You know, you got to kind of like them a little bit, but they were always real nice to us.
Did Buddy and Little Richard get on well?
Oh, yeah, they got to be good buddies. I think Little Richard appreciated what Buddy was doing, and he knew Buddy had been a fan of his since Tutti Frutti, which I guess was his first record.
We might hear them talking among themselves, you know, they'd say, it's just another one record act, you know. They'll have one record and they'll be down the tube like so many have been. But then a lot of them were sincere, and as you asked, they did try to help us, you know. And like Chuck Berry. Super guy. If I ever ask him anything, you know, it was, well, let's sit down and talk about it, you know. And in fact, he would invite me. We were traveling on a bus most of the time. And Chuck Berry had his Cadillac that he traveled in. He would invite me to travel with him occasionally. In the car, which really, you know, was much better than riding that bus. And we'd talk about everything.
Don and I didn't have a band. We didn't travel with a band and all, and the Crickets were on the show. Jerry Lee was on the show. And Don and I were headlining. The second half consisted of the Crickets opening, the second half, Jerry Lee, and then Don and I. Well, Don and I got down there, and the booker had supplied us with three high school boys that couldn't play. You know, so in essence, like, you really had a band that you couldn't go on with. So we were stuck, and we opened up that night, and Buddy volunteered to play for us. And it was one of the best, of course, Jerry Lee. Without Buddy, I don't know if we could have followed Jerry Lee at the time, because Buddy had them really worked over, and, you know, they were really on their feet. And then Jerry Lee came out and do his great act. But only by the grace of God and Buddy Holly and the Crickets did Don and I manage to pull it off. But when Buddy Holly came back and played for us and we did our stuff, it was just pandemonium.
All of my sisters, you don't know what you've been. I bet you know, boy, when you're with me, oh boy. I thought the world could say that you were the best for me. All of my life, I've been waiting, and I shall be no hesitating, oh boy, when you're with me, oh boy. I thought the world could say that you were meant for me. Stars appear and the shadows are falling. You can hear my heart calling. A little bit of love, it makes everything right. I'm gonna see my baby tonight. All of my love, all of my kissing. You don't know what you've been missing, oh boy. When you're with me, oh boy. I thought the world could say that you were meant for me. No boy, when you're with me, oh boy, I thought the world could say that you were meant for me. All my life I've been waiting, and I'll be no hesitating, no boy, when you're with me, oh boy, I thought the world could say that you were meant for me. Stars appear and the shadows are falling. You can hear my heart calling. A little bit of love, it makes everything right. I'm gonna see my baby tonight. All of my love, all of my kissing. You don't know just what you've been missing, no boy. When you're with me, oh boy, I thought the world could say that you were meant for me.
I can remember one time they had these things in Lubbock they call fair tours. They get a band, local band in Lubbock, and they go around to small towns around Lubbock, and they call it the fair tour because they were promoting the South Plains Fair. And Sonny and Buddy and Don Yes, I believe, were on this deal. And Buddy got stopped on the for speeding in the car on the way to to start the tour or something. And the policeman said, "Hey, you know, got on his face." He said, "Hey, man, you know, like, I'm going to go do a fair tour to promote this fair for this county, and you know, and you're stopping me, and you're going to give me a ticket, charge me money when I'm hurrying down to get to this deal to do something good for the state and the county, and I'm just doing good." And, you know, you had that kind of attitude, like, "Hey, what are you talking about? Fooling with me? Because I'm not hurting anybody." And, well, he was real confident. If the police would stop most folks, like me, I'd say, "Sorry, sir, I didn't mean to be speeding." You know?
Oh, he remember when he got his Meerschaum pipe. His Meerschaum pipe. I never heard of one either. And he came backstage, and he was holding it by the little black part, and this big white pipe was sticking out here, curved and everything. And I says, "But they says it's a Meerschaum." He says, "You can't touch it with your hands." Says, "Gets grease on it." Says, "And you got it, turns the bowl." So he was walking around with his pipe. He was meticulous like that, and he had a little case he put it in and everything.
When Buddy bought something, he bought the best there was to get. Like when he bought his first Fender Stratocaster, you know, I think that was the first one in Lubbock, Texas, and I couldn't believe that was a guitar. That was the first solid body guitar I'd ever seen. And, you know, with a gear shift on it, man, you know, you can change tones with that. And I'm very impressed with it. And I think a lot of other people were too. And after we did our first tour in Europe, seems like everybody wanted to talk to Buddy about his guitar.
Up to heaven, when you took me in your arms, I was dazzled by your kisses, blinded by your charm.
In a fool's paradise.
Fool's paradise.
Good and lost.
Good and lost.
In a fool's paradise. When you told me that you loved me, I gave my heart to you. And I wondered if there could be any truth in love so new. I was lost. In a fool's paradise.
Fool's paradise.
Good and lost.
Good and lost.
In a fool's paradise.
I believe this is Heathrow. It says London Airport. Would that be, that probably be what it is then. And this is part of the tour. We were on a 3-week tour with the band and comedians and singers. It was really a lot of fun. This is Cambridge. And old Jerry turned around real quick. I don't know who's pulling the shirt there. That's Buddy and Joe B. And there was Wally. He was our manager, road manager. And I'm standing there with Wally. I don't believe that Jerry and Joe B and Buddy really saw much of the country. Seems like they stayed up all night and they slept on the bus all the way. They were just piled all over each other in the bus. I believe this is Salisbury, the old George Hotel. It was really neat. The ladies fixed us hot chocolate at night. We sat in front of the fireplace.
The rock and roll tours here had like 20, around 20 acts on them. And I mean, all rock and rollers, everybody had a hit record or two hit records or whatever. And then we went to England and there was like a juggling act. And Des O'Connor was the announcer and a comedian. And the Tanner Sisters. And there was the band Ronnie Keane. It was like a 14-piece band. And but anyway, we were the only rock and rollers on the whole deal. Well, Buddy always jumped around a lot and acted silly, and Joe B would lay on his back and play the bass, and Holly would get down singing Joe B's bass mic, and I mean, we just act as crazy as possible. You know, it really rock and roll it. Well, the whole thing was just really fun, because it's like going to England is such a change. And we were accepted real well. I think Bill Haley had been there before us, but other than that, there hadn't been any rock and roll in England. And everybody was marveling. We thought, well, aren't we the ones?
That was the first record we ever made with the Beatles in a little studio in Liverpool. We just went up there one day and made this little shellac record. I think we were hearing all the kind of stuff like the sort of Stargazers, you know, those kind of vocal groups. And there was people like Guy Mitchell, you know, sort of, and Tommy Steele. And Lonnie Donegan was the big sort of starter over here, you know, for a lot of the English people. But then there started to come in these like very exciting records just over the radio, and you didn't really know, you know, like now there's an expression, where it's coming from. Then you didn't know where that kind of thing was coming from. That'll Be the Day, for instance, like a very exciting record. You didn't know if they were black, white, it didn't really matter. Just a very sort of electric sound on the radio. And you just got intrigued by these things, I think, you know, this kind of mystic image coming over the radio of these sort of strange new music. I mean, obviously, like all these years later, it's difficult to just say what it was about a person. But then I think you were looking at all the stars like Elvis,
and over in England, Cliff Rich and stuff. And they were all they're really good-looking fellas, you know. And then Buddy came along, and he was a fellow with glasses. And you'd never really seen anyone with glasses. You know, it always seemed that anyone who had glasses couldn't make it as a singer or stuff, or at least they had to take their glasses off and have contacts in or something. But suddenly this singer appeared, you know, these big horn-rimmed specs, and we were getting ready to start the Beatles and thinking of making a group. So John Lennon, who normally wore the horn-rimmed specs but always took them off on stage, he was now able to put them on and see the world, you know. The only thing I remember was Sunday night at the Palladium. We used to have a big variety show. And Buddy was on that once, and that was the big occasion to watch his fingers, to see what guitar he had, and to see if he played the chords right, and to see how he did that solo in Peggy Sue, and see whether he used a capo or not. And, you know, all the various technical things, that was where you got your info.
I'm well aware that I've lifted a few of his licks on solos here and there, especially on the road, you know. That's the other great thing about Buddy, it was a working music, you know, it worked on stage. You could do it in the studio and you could do it on stage, you know, without any extra effort, it worked. You know, it was a beautiful piece of precision work, you know, performance, whatever, writing, the whole thing was... He had it all. What can you say, lucky devil?
I want to tell you how it's going to be. You're going to give your love to me. I'm going to love you night and day. Well, you know my love and I fade away. You know my love and I fade away. My love bigger than a Cadillac. I tried to show it and it tried me back. How I feel. Love real, not fade away. Well, love real, not fade away.
Hey. Maybe it was the fact of doing Buddy's song that also gave us that extra provocation to start writing our own stuff, you know, because we'd done our gig, you know, we'd recorded it and it was great and everything was successful. Well, now you're a star, now what's next? And I think Buddy's inspiration, that point of view, in that he wrote his own songs, which obviously influenced the Beatles incredibly. Yeah. And slowly dawned on us that, you know, it would be great if one of us could write some songs, two of us would be fantastic. And I think maybe doing Buddy's songs sort of maybe promoted and got us together to start trying to write songs.
We used to write songs like Buddy. The very first songs that John and I wrote, we used to sag off school and go to my house and sit down with guitars and... I was a cuckoo, you was a you know, and all that. We just, how did he do it, you know? I love it, you know, we just try that for hours and hours. And eventually, out of it, we got a couple of little songs, you know, we got Love Me Do, which was the first Beatles record. Love Me Do. It's sort of the same, you know, I love you. It's like the same two, three chords job, you know. It wasn't quite as bad as that. But, you know, it all came out of this idea of three chords, a group, standing up there, playing your instruments while you do, you can see echoes of Buddy Holly and the Crickets in the Beatles.
One and only Buddy Holly. Buddy Holly. Buddy Holly. Hey, Buddy.
How are you, Alan?
How are you?
Well, we haven't been working all summer, Alan. We've just been kind of loafing and taking it easy and running around some, enjoying the what we hadn't enjoyed for the whole year previous, you know, all the work going on.
Oh, boy, you worked hard that year, Buddy.
So we're getting ready to start in some new work now.
You going on tour again?
And I think so, huh?
Buddy, we had a lot of fun. We did a lot of flying.
Yeah, we sure did. You know, I was just in the town the other day in Cincinnati. Remember when we landed there and the helicopter had crashed that day that we got in there?
That's right. Buddy, we played, I think we rode every kind of airplane there was imaginable.
We sure did.
Those DC-3s were really something.
Oh, boy.
Without the seatbelts, we'd have been right through the top, that's sure. For sure. Well, we had a lot of fun together, and Buddy, let's get together soon, and thank you so much for being with us. All
thank you, Alan. It's been my pleasure.
Thank you.
We'd been riding our motorcycles when we were sitting around on a curb on 6th Street in Lubbock, Texas. And we'd had an offer come in for a tour. And I was saying, hey, buddy, what? You know, I was trying to talk him into doing the tour. And he said, well, let's take some time off and enjoy ourselves. And I said, no, I don't know. You know, we may not, you know, what if records quit selling? We can't make this much money in a year or two. We better do this tour now instead of waiting, you know, and, you know, maybe later on we can't do it. And he said, well, what are you wanting to buy a Cadillac or something you don't have? And I said, well, no, not really. And he said, man, if you want a Cadillac, I'll buy you a Cadillac. I said, no, that's not it. He said, well, man, what if you got killed tomorrow, you know, and you didn't have any time to enjoy the money we've already made? What about that? You know, if we just work all the time and don't enjoy ourselves? And I said, you're right, you know, like, that's exactly right. Forget that tour, let's don't do it. Let's take some time off and ride our motorcycles and fool around. We just got married and all that. So, I just shut up. I mean, that was a whole new thought for me. Like, hey, what if you did get killed tomorrow?
Heartbeat, why do you miss when my baby kisses me?
Nobody knew that I was married to Buddy. We kept it kind of quiet because of that particular time. Nobody felt that celebrities should be married.
Riddly Pat, I know that new love thrills me. I know that true love will be heartbeat.
I met Buddy in New York at Southern Music Publishing Company. He came in. He wanted to see Mari Deutsch. He was very pleasant. I like him at first sight. Then he asked through other people. He wanted me to have lunch with him. He didn't ask me directly, which I did. That same day, we went to buy some guitar strings for him. In the process of doing that, he asked me to have dinner with him, which I did. We went out to dinner. And that same night, while we were having dinner, he asked me to marry him. To me, that was a little bit fast, I guess for everybody else would be too. And I took it as a mere joke. And after that I said, well, yes, I'll marry you, of course. When do you want to get married? Now or later? He says, well, later would be all right. But I said, well, okay, come talk to my aunt, which he did, which I was okay too. I just fell in love with a guy, obviously. And so 2 weeks after that first meeting, we got married in Lubbock. And that sounds like a fairy tale situation, but to me it was. It was a real fairy tale courtship.
Peggy Sue and I got married in June, like June 22nd. And so Peggy Sue and I sort of waited to go on our honeymoon until Buddy and Maria Elena got married. Then we all went to Mexico together, went to Acapulco. And it was uncomfortable, the whole sort of thing was. And all of a sudden, then it wasn't like Joe B and Buddy and I hanging out. It was like all of a sudden, I wanted to hang out with Peggy Sue and Buddy wanted to hang out with Maria Elena. And it was weird. We couldn't talk to each other as much as we had before. And then the next tour we went on after that, which was the last tour we went on, Peggy Sue stayed home, and Joe B and I took a station wagon, and Buddy, he and Maria Lane took a car, so we weren't like, it wasn't the friendship deal like it had been, so it got weird.
I like to think of it not necessarily as breaking up. The Crickets and Buddy Holly quit performing together. Buddy had married and had aspirations of going on to bigger and better things, I'm sure, and I think he might possibly have been influenced by his wife. He wanted to get away from the manager that we were with at the time, and wanted to go to New York, try new things, orchestration-wise and whatever. And like I said before, Buddy was headstrong. You know, when he had his mind made up to do something, he did it. So he just said, guys, I'm going to move to New York where I can be close to the record companies, the publishers, and this and that. And I hope you guys will go along. Of course, J.I. and I had decided we wanted to stay back where we grew up and not get involved in the big business end of it.
Oh, well, the little things you say and do make me want to be with you. Rain on, it's a crazy feeling, and I know it's got me reeling when you say I love you.
We lived in Greenwich Village, and we took an apartment on 8th Street and 5th Avenue. And that was a very different environment for him, because coming from Lubbock and moving into Greenwich Village, which was very, you know, completely artist and very liberal type of living, like you would get up in the middle of the night, like we did, in our pajamas, put them up, put a raincoat on, and move on to a pub there that you people call a pub. We call it, at that time, a bar or a lounge, really. And we just go there or go to a place where they have the coffee houses, as they had a lot of them at that time. And we just sat there and talked to people, or people that would be like a comic night. And we would just sit there. And this was on and on. 3, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the morning, all night long. I want him to have pictures taken. We went to Bruno, one of the best in New York at the time. I wanted a portfolio for him. He was getting involved with even his most cherished dream was to be in movies, which was very unusual at that time. He admired Anthony Perkins at that time. Says, I love the way I want to be like Anthony Perkins, you know, one of his idols at that time with the movie. And I said, well, why just dream about it? Why not get involved?
Here am I, oh well, you left me here so I could sit and cry. Well, golly gee, what have you done to me? Oh well, I guess it doesn't matter anymore. Do you remember, baby, last September, how you held me tight each and every night? Well, whoops-a-daisy, how you drove me crazy, but I guess it doesn't matter anymore.
The last time I saw Buddy, and we had a long time to visit, was he was up in Eddie Cochran's room, you know, and they called, and I came over. We went back to his place, and he played me all of his cuts. He had a professional machine in his house, in the middle of his living room it was, and we sat there and listened to, about 6 cuts. Sounded great to me, you know, and he was at that time looking to get a hit, and he told me that he was going to stay off the road till he got a hit. But I think some of his circumstances, financially, with problems he was having, and maybe with Petty and all of them, forced him to get out on the road.
Is that why he went on the last tour, do you think?
That's what I suspect, because if I go with just what I know, a Buddy, the last time I saw Buddy was at a lawyer's office. We were coming out as he was coming in, and he was trying to resolve this problem of money that he thought himself owed. And I think if he'd had that money, he would have waited until one of his songs had gone top 10.
Hearts that are broken and love that's untrue, these go with learning the game. When you love her and she doesn't love you, you're only learning the game. When she says that you're the only one she'll ever love, then you find that you are not the one she's thinking of. Feeling so sad and you're all alone and blue, that's when you're learning the game.
It's cold. It's really cold. We were out 12 days before they got killed, and we had 8 different buses in that 12-day period. One night, we was just driving down the road, and the bus just froze up. I mean, just literally stopped. We was going up this hill, and it was so cold outside. The bus froze, so we were left sitting in the middle of the road on this bus with no heat. So we burning papers in the aisle, and our drummer got his feet frostbite, or got frostbite in his feet just sitting on the bus. So we had to leave him there. I think it was Green Bay, Wisconsin, somewhere in that area. We left him in the hospital, so he was in the hospital when the guys got killed. We played a job that night. Of course, we didn't have a drummer, and Richie Valens played drums with us. One of the Belmonts played drums when Richie was on. Buddy played drums behind somebody. You know, he'd jump out there and play drums. But anyhow, he wanted to fly because we'd been out 12 days. We didn't get our laundry done, and like I said, it had been really cold on those buses. So he chartered this plane to take 3 people. Me and him and Waylon was going to fly. Well, Big Bopper had kind of got the flu that afternoon, so he wanted to go ahead and get in early the next day and get him a shot at a doctor. So sometime that night, Waylon gave up his seat to the Bopper. And when I went back in, Richie was in there signing autographs. And he said, "You going to let me fly a guy?" And I said, "No." And he says, "Come on." He says, "Flip." He had a half a dollar. He says, "Let's flip a coin." He said, "Heads I go and tails you go." So he flipped the coin. I said, "Okay, if you want to go that bad." And he had never flown on a small plane before in his life, which is kind of ironic, you know. But I don't know why I did it, because all night long he had asked me to go, and I said no. But for some reason, I said, "Go ahead, you know, if you even want to go that bad." Well, he won the toss, so I walked back out. He got in the station wagon. I walked back to the station wagon. I guess I was probably the last one to talk to Buddy, because I said, "Buddy, I got a registered letter to post office my mother sent to Fargo. Would you pick it up for me?" And he said, "Yeah." He said, "I need some identification. Let me have your driver's license." So I said, "Here, take my wallet." So he just stuck my wallet in his pocket, you know. So when the plane was found the next morning, they found 4 bodies and 5 identifications. So the first news that went out, I was listed as one of the dead because they found my ID, see.
My sister called me and told me about it. Woke me up, as a matter of fact. It was unbelievable, of course, to me, and I wouldn't accept it until I went down and got a newspaper. And, of course, basically all I had to do was turn on the radio. And it still took me a long time to accept the fact. In fact, probably a couple of years. Because I kept thinking it was maybe a publicity stunt, or Buddy's not really gone. Because I didn't see him, you know. It was a closed casket funeral. And I just wouldn't accept the reality. Of course, I guess it's that way with any time someone loses a relative or someone as close to them as Buddy was to me, or I should say as Buddy and I were. And I just didn't want to accept it. I just knew one day he's going to be walking down the street, you know, and I'll see him.
Oh, I know my dreams cannot come true. All those precious things we shared together. Time goes by.
makes it tough. Oh, so tough. When you tell me you don't love me, that makes it tough. Oh, so tough. Say you don't care for me no more.
He had an influence on everybody, everybody that's playing now that's just come out as well, because what they've listened to is it's been handed on, you know. His Buddy was one of the, he was in the union, you know. No, he's one of the troubadours. You just pass it on, yeah. And he passed it on via the Beatles, via us. Everything he did is, I mean, you still hear it on the radio today, a brand new release, but you hear Buddy Holly in there. You can't, you know, he's in everybody. How much? And there is another thing, you know, but this is not bad from a guy from Lubbock, right?
And tell me how you feel. Tell me love is real. Words of love you whisper soft and true. Darling, I love you. Whisper soft and true. Darling, I love you.
Boy, I just can't get on it, Norm. The page just blurs. Can't even see the word, looking right at him. I've gone through it so many times, it's just... going, you know, it's a circle, and the circle tightens up and catches up with it, and another time comes before it's time to sing this one. That's what's getting me so bad, is the concentration.
Crap time.
We'll make the crap out, I'll just tell you for sure. Let's go.
Next tonight on BBC Four, an Oscar-winning film continues our evening marking the 50th anniversary of The Day the Music Died. Stay tuned for the Buddy Holly story.
It's a getting closer, going faster than a roller coaster. Love like yours will surely come.